Mm-hmm. Thank you. Now's the time you've been waiting for. Your attention, please. The show is about to start. And I am so excited about having you all here. And this event, the idea for it, we got it in the beginning of December. And anyone that's planned an event this large knows that it takes months, right? Well, we pulled it off. You're here. And before the evening is over, I will thank all the people that were responsible for it. But for now, I would like to thank you all for being here. And I'd like to start the program with a young lady in the first grade named Gloria, who's going to do the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And I'd like to introduce our MC for the evening, Michael Patrick Leahy of the Tennessee Star.
Thank you, Carol. What a great evening, and how about a great round of applause for our good friend and great leader, Carol Swain.
Thank you.
It is great to see everybody here this evening. Usually, I host the Tennessee Star Report on Talk Radio 98.3 and 1510 WLAC. It starts at thank you. We have our one listener. Thank you very much. But I usually start it out by saying, good morning, Nashville. It's 5:06 in the morning. We're broadcasting live from Music Row. Well, good evening, Nashville. We have a great program for you tonight. And since it is Nashville, we have asked our good friend, Karen Harding, a gospel singer from Nashville, Tennessee, to sing the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Oh, don't you love living in Nashville, Tennessee? with great, great talent like that. Speaking of talent, I want to introduce our very first musical guest this evening. You may have heard him or heard of him. His name is John Rich. Singer-songwriter John Rich makes up one half of the country group Big and Rich. He has a very busy and successful year last year. On the music side of things, he and Big Kenny, that's the other half of Big and Rich, maintained a steady tour schedule throughout the year. And then, over the holidays, you may have heard this, John Rich released a Christmas song with Mike Rowe called Santa's Got a Dirty Job. And that topped the all-genre singles chart on both iTunes and Billboard. It's a fabulous song. John Rich hosts the Fox Business Network show, The Pursuit, with John Rich, where he discusses the right to pursue the American dream and the dedication and passion that it takes to set and achieve your own goals. It is a great pleasure to introduce this evening Mr. John Rich. Now, I'm going to say a few words about our next guest, who will be introduced by John Rich. Our next guest, Larry Gatlin. Country star Larry Gatlin is the oldest of the three Gatlin brothers. Larry became known throughout the Nashville music industry through the strength of his songwriting talents, penning every Gatlin brother hit you've ever heard. He's written songs that were later recorded by Elvis Presley, Glenn Campbell, wait for it, Barbara Streisand, Johnny Cash, Barry Gibb, and many more. In October of 2019, he was inducted into the prestigious Nashville Songwriters Hall of Fame. John, would you like to do the honors?
Absolutely. So, first of all, it's good to be with you guys tonight. Thank you to Dr. Carol Swain for the invite. Good to be in Middle Tennessee. Listen, this gentleman here, I get to introduce him. What an honor. Listened to his music my whole life. I've had the great pleasure of becoming his personal friend. I would call him a mentor of mine. He's given me some of the best advice I've ever had in my life, and I put it to use. He's a patriot. He loves this country. He loves people. He loves Americans. He loves people that work hard and dream big and chase the American dream. One of the greatest that ever did it in this town, the one and only Mr. Larry Gatlin, ladies and gentlemen. So they asked us to sing a little bit.
How do you do that with a hat on?
And we got the call from Dr. Swain. She said, would you boys mind coming in and singing a little bit? And we said, don't threaten us with a good time. Right, Larry? That's what we said.
That's exactly. Good evening. Good evening. John Boy?
You got some guitar out there? Just want to make sure we got it. Turn everything up loud. We're kind of deaf. We played a lot of shows, so.
Let's see here. Is that it?
I got a little bit now, a little bit. Make it louder. There we go.
Okay.
Too loud.
You want to, you think we ought to tune, or if we don't tune, it'll sound
Let
like
me hear
more
a chord from you, because we ain't even tuned yet. What do you got? That's pretty close.
How about it?
So, if I was going to be a Gatlin brother, which brother would I be? I get to step in the role tonight. Or is this Gatlin and Rich? I mean, what's going on
this
here?
This is old and rich. Well, you know, I do call you little brother for a reason. I feel like you've been, I wouldn't be back in this town. Janice and I lived here for 21 years and then moved to Austin, Texas for 18 years. And, little brother over here said, won't you come back to Nashville? Let's write some songs together. And we've been hanging around. And he appreciates the old classic country music, kind of took me under his wing, and I took him under the other one. We've had a great relationship, great friendship. He is a true patriot and true American. I love John Rich. I do.
Thank you, sir. So make sure that guitar's on.
Are you in tune?
We're in tune. Let's get Larry's guitar on. That way I can hear it. Hit the button. What you going to sing?
Why don't we start with...
We're both Texans. There you go.
Well, Houston. Houston means that I'm one day closer. Hey, friends and neighbors, this was a big old hit, and we're doing this free. We're going to start it one more time. Well, Houston. Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Yeah, honey, Houston. Houston means the last day of the tour we're through. Yeah, honey, you and God in heaven above, no, I love what I do for a living. I really do. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Hey, John, you know how I wrote this song? People ask a lot of times, how'd you write those songs?
Sorry, I didn't know the rules to the Gatlin show.
Well, that's all right. When Larry talks, everybody... Okay, here's what the deal was. Here's what the deal was. Brother Steve, Brother Rudy, and I, we were at the Omaha State Fair. The Nebraska State Fair in Omaha. They do not call it the Nebraska State Fair. They call it Exarban. That's Nebraska spelled backwards. You can't make this up. That is the name of the Nebraska State Fair. So we did the Nebraska State Fair. We did Exarban. The next day, we were going to do the Cheyenne Frontier Days, a big rodeo. And, the brothers took the buses that night. I had an interview to do. So, hey, John, come here. Scott.
I'm following him. So
here, this is true. You can't.
We only got 30 minutes, by the way.
This is a good story,
Uncle.
So we the boys went to Cheyenne. I took the plane the next day. We got, and on the way over to Cheyenne from Denver, I thought I'd write this little song for him. So I wrote, Cheyenne means I'm one day closer to you. Cheyenne means the last day of the tour and we're through. It was all touchy-feely. That's the time when all of us songwriters in Nashville were trying to get in touch with our inner Paul Simon, you know. Like a... Anyway, I got to the Cheyenne Rodeo and I taught the boys. Cheyenne means I'm one... Brother Steve said, Big Brother, that really stinks. He said, tomorrow we're going to be in our home state. We're going to sing at the Houston Livestock Show, the biggest rodeo on the face of the earth. Said, if you'll change that little... Cheyenne means I'm one day closer to you. Put it in a little 4/4 shuffle, you might have something. So I changed. Cheyenne means I'm one day closer to you. What'd I change it to? Well, Houston. Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Yeah, honey, Houston. Houston means the last day of the tour we're through. Yeah, honey, you. Heaven above, now I love what I do for a living, I do. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Well, now singing at the world's biggest rodeo sure was a great time for me and you guys. Oh, but when I'm away from you, honey, time always never flies. Sleeping all alone in that holiday hotel show makes a cowboy blue. But here I am in Houston and I'm one day closer to you. Everybody. Houston. Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Yeah, honey, Houston. Houston means the last day of the tour we're through. Yeah, honey, you have God in heaven. Oh, no, I love what I do for a living, I really do. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Well, Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Yeah, honey, Houston, Houston means the last day of the turn we're through. Yeah, honey, you and God in heaven, Bob, no, I love what I do. If I were living, I really do. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you.
Tag it, John.
Yeah, Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you.
That's it.
Hey!
Of course he knew.
We got any Johnny Cash fans down here in Tennessee tonight, huh? Give me some guitar, son, so I don't tear the strings off of it. God bless Johnny Cash. God bless the United States of America. God bless Dr. Carol Swain tonight. Can I get a hell yeah out of this crowd one time? Give me a little more guitar, son.
Well, love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery rain. Well, bound by wild desire, say I fell into a ring of fire.
Y'all help me sing it.
Say I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher, and it burns, burns, burns. Ring of fire, ring of fire.
Y'all sing the trumpet part.
Say da 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 da.
Good job.
Yeah, the taste of love is sweet when hearts like ours meet. Well, I feel for you like a child. Oh, and the fire went wild.
Y'all help me sing it.
Say I fell into a ring of fire. I went down. Yes, and it burns, burns, burns. Bring a fire, bring a fire.
Y'all sing the trumpet part.
Say da 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 da.
Feels good.
Da 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 da.
Do it again.
Say da 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 da.
Let me hear you one last time.
Say da 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 da.
Put your hands together for yourself and Johnny Cash up in here tonight. God bless y'all. I want to say, good job, Dr. Carol Swain. Good job.
Talk to him.
Good
I'm gonna
job.
Go get, I'm going to go get my capo. Talk to him. I can only play one key without my capo.
Dr. Swain, we're so proud of you tonight for putting on this event. You are an example that stands in direct contrast to what a lot of our culture is saying is true. You prove them all to be liars with your own life and with your own success that you've had and where you came from and where you sit here tonight and no doubt where you're going. You blow them out of the water every single time you step on the stage. You can stand up for the doctor. Absolutely. Now, I was told there was thousands of people that got really upset that this event was going to happen tonight. And how dare Dr. Carol Swain and how dare Dr. Ben Carson show up in this building in Tennessee and have this event. How dare they do that?
Yeah.
And they got so upset that they had petitions and said they was going to try to wreck this nice event and things like that. Well, here's what I have to say about that. The only way that you know you're truly having impact is if you have a wave of hate coming back at you. A wave of hate. Let me put it another way. If you don't have a wave of hate coming at you, then you're not saying it right, you're not doing it right, and you're not standing up tall enough for the truth. That's an actual fact. We can go back into the scripture and we can quote the words of the Son of God himself when he said, I'd rather you be hot or cold, but if you're in the middle, I'll spit you out of my mouth. He also said, if they're going to crucify me, what do you think they're going to do to you? That's what he said. So if nobody's persecuting you and your life is just hunky-dory every single day from the time you wake up till you go back to bed, closely examine your position in current-day America. You should have people that hate everything you say and hate what you stand for. That is validation that you're having impact. Thank God for people like Carol Swain.
Amen.
Thank God for people like her that are willing to stand up and take it. God bless you, Doctor. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Larry Gatlin.
For Dr. Swain, and you know, John, when you're talking about the scripture, I wrote this song. You did the Johnny Cash, Ring of Fire. John did this one. I sang this one at his going away party. It's for all of us. Lord, help me walk another mile, just one more mile. I'm tired of walking all alone. Lord, help me smile another smile, just one more smile. I know I just can't make on my own. I never thought I needed help before. I thought that I could do things all by myself, but now I know I just can't take anymore. With a humble heart on bended knees, I'm begging you please for help. Come down from your golden throne to me, to lowly me. I need to feel the touch of your tender hand. Lord, let us feel the touch of your hand. We need it. Remove the chains of darkness and let me see, Lord, let me see just where I fit into your master plan. I never thought I needed help before. I thought that I could get by myself. Now I know I just can't take it anymore. With a humble heart on bended knees, I'm begging you please for help. And we're thanking you for help right now. Amen.
Larry, you're a handsome man.
Thank you, John.
I mean, I'm pretty sure that we could start on Outlaw Gang right now dressed like this. I mean, we're set for it.
I think we could.
Yeah.
Because we're pretty much outlaws anyway. We're all outlaws right now, huh?
Oh yeah. They're all upset at us. Good.
Hey, y'all know something?
You know what?
You were talking about a while ago.
Hang on a second. They're upset at us. They're upset at us. Really? You're upset at us. We've done what to you? We've done what to this country other than work our asses off, try to raise our kids, and chase the American dream? Beyond that, what have we done to you? You're mad at us. Bunch of idiots. And they are taking things that are sacred to this country and they're flipping them around in a mirror image, trying to say, oh no, we're going to redefine that. We're going to redefine it in our image, in our communist, Marxist image. We're going to redefine it. Oh, well, you can redefine it in your group. But none of the rest of us are believing that. I don't know if you saw the latest poll. Oh, Biden's down to 33%. It's probably more like 23%. You can't believe polls. It's probably, here's what I say. I say, hey, man, you got 3 more years. Let's be goal-driven. Can we be at 0% by the time you leave? You know what's going to happen. Dare to dream, Joe. Dare to dream. They're mad at us. Good. I'm glad they're mad at us.
Yeah.
Because guess what? When you got a poll that's down in the lower 30s, guess what that means? A vast majority of his own party have realized who he is and what they're trying to do to this country. There's a lot of Democrats out there that I've met that say, I can't even identify with it anymore. And I'll tell you this on top of that. I know a lot of Republicans that I would not trust as far as I could throw them by their pinky toe right now.
That's right.
Never. You can't trust Republicans and you can't trust Democrats. You can only trust the American dream and real Americans that know what this country's all about. The ones that really believe as to why this country is special and unique. There's a reason why there are lines coming in. And there ain't no lines going out. It's because we're the only country in the history of the world, of recorded history, that has given its citizens not the right to be happy, the right to pursue happiness.
Amen.
The right to go for it. Yeah? Only us. I had a thought the other day, Larry. I was thinking about the nature of God. I was reading a little bit. God is limitless, correct? He's limitless. And it says we're created in God's image, right?
Right.
We're created in an image of a God that is limitless. So that means through him, we should also live and think and breathe and move as if we are also limitless, right?
Yeah. Yes,
if we're
right.
In his image.
Yes.
So anybody that tries to build any kind of structure that limits the human's potential is the enemy of God's intent. Would that be correct?
I believe that, brother. Preach on. I'm with you. I'm with you.
Is that a simple thought?
Yeah.
We're supposed to be limitless. We're supposed to live as though we're limitless. We're supposed to exhaust our potential. And the biggest threat to tyranny are free people that know they can go as far as they can possibly go. That's why they're trying to cut us back, and we can't let them do it. That's why we're here tonight, and I'm proud to be here.
I'll tell you one thing.
Simple thoughts, simple thoughts.
Fear not. Fear not is not a suggestion. It's a commandment. He didn't say fear not if you want to. Go on, John boy. We're limitless. Go on.
That's right. We're going to do one more song, and then we're going to bring up, listen, one of the greatest thinkers, one of the greatest patriots, really, in our lifetimes, Dr. Ben Carson, is going to come up here and speak to us tonight. God bless you, Dr. Carson. We'll do one more song. So I would call this song, Larry, the modern-day Star Spangled Banner. You ain't going to replace the Star Spangled Banner. But for us, the ones of us that are live today, I have the same kind of feeling when I hear this song as when I hear the Star Spangled Banner. And we were talking about it earlier, and there's a Nashville icon that was involved with this song. Would you mind telling us a little bit about this man?
30 years ago, I got a call from a fellow named Jerry Crutchfield. He passed away this morning. Jerry Crutchfield said, Larry, get your boys together. He said, you know, I'm doing a little album on Lee Greenwood. And said, we got this little patriotic song. Said, we don't know if it's going to be that big a deal, but we want y'all to sing some Gatlin Brothers harmony on it. So the very first one, we went in there and sang this song. And it was a great honor for us to do that. And we've sung it with Lee all over the world, and he has sung it all over the world. And you talk about a great patriot. And I think the rallying cry that's been for the conservative movement for the last 30 years is this song. John Boy, sing it for him, and I'll sing a little harmony. All right, go ahead.
If tomorrow all the things were gone I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again, just my children and my wife. Thank my lucky stars to be living here today, where the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away.
Carson and each and every one of y'all, have a great night. We're going to win this thing. We're going to win this thing. Can I get a yeehaw one time? Mr. Larry Gatlin, everyone.
Little brother John Riff.
How do you follow that? Oh, my goodness. Let's have another hand for John Rich and Larry Gatlin. Well, I hope you'll take a look at all the information you have on your table and learn more about Carol's nonprofit, Be the People. If you believe in Carol and in her mission, I hope you will consider making a donation. They're doing everything they can to educate people on conservative values and principles, honoring our Constitution and true racial reconciliation in our communities. Isn't that great? Now, I have the privilege of introducing Dr. Carol Swain. Carol is a good friend of mine. And if you listen in our radio program in the morning, she's often on as an all-star panelist. And Carol has such a compelling story. She was born into poverty in Virginia, not too far from where Booker T. Washington was born. At the age of 16, she dropped out of high school, married, and had a child. She got her GED. She's earned 5 college degrees, including a PhD from the University of North Carolina. She was honored as one of the up-and-coming national stars in the world of political science, in the academic world of political science. She was a professor at Princeton University and then a professor at Vanderbilt. But a few years ago, she made a momentous decision. She realized Vanderbilt University, well, these are my words, not hers. Vanderbilt was part of the problem. And Carol went out, very brave. How many professors with tenure decide, hey, I'm going to leave this safe job and venture out into the world? You know, professors are good at doing research, but actually making money, doing something useful, not something they're particularly good at for the most part. Carol subsequently ran for mayor of Nashville. Now, I don't know if you've looked lately, but I can tell you this. She didn't win. A guy by the name of John Cooper won. Do you think Nashville would have been better off if Carol Swain was our mayor? Absolutely. Well, Carol has established this nonprofit, Be the People nonprofit. And she also is now a distinguished senior fellow for constitutional studies at the Texas Public Policy Foundation. This is very, very important organization. Perhaps we have a terrific organization here at the Beacon Center, but perhaps the Texas Public Policy Foundation is the most significant conservative think tank at a state level in the country. And they came to her and said, can you help us? And Carol Swain said yes. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct privilege to introduce to you tonight, Dr. Carol Swain.
Thank you so much. As Michael has indicated with his words about my background, I am a product of the American dream, and so is Dr. Carson, and so are many of you. Like many of the people from my generation came from less desirable circumstances, we worked very hard to get to where we are today. And for Black Americans, it was especially hard. And I can tell you that I was born in 1954. That was the year of the Brown versus Board of Education school desegregation case. And that case that ordered schools to be desegregated with all deliberate speed, in Virginia, where I was born, it took until 1968 or 1969 for the schools to be desegregated. In fact, the governor of Virginia led a massive resistance. He was a Democrat, by the way, resistance to integration. And I can also tell you that the first Republican governor of Virginia, right after his name was Linwood Houlton, right after he was elected, he took his young children by the hands and walked them into Richmond Public Schools, and he enrolled his children into predominantly Black schools. And that was Virginia's first Republican governor. And this conference, taking place this weekend, is to honor Dr. Martin Luther King. Because without his vision, Without his vision and his strategy, we would not have had a successful civil rights movement. And I am a beneficiary of that civil rights movement, and so are you. Everyone in this room benefited from Dr. Martin Luther King. And if you have not read his letter from a Birmingham jail that was written in April 1963, he was in jail in Birmingham, Alabama. He wrote that letter, and if you read those words, if we were to read those words and just focus on what he was saying today, we would be so much further along with race relations, because he was not about polarization. He recognized the dignity of all individuals, and he was always very careful to include white people and black people and all people. He did not advocate polarization. And the I Have a Dream speech, and this American Dream Conference, the I Have a Dream speech was given in August of 1963. And I'm not going to do him a lot of justice by reading it, but I'm going to read those words, excerpts of that speech tonight. And I would like for you all to just think about what Dr. King said to that audience of over 200,000 people in August 1963, and also think about our nation, where we are today, and the lessons that we can learn from Dr. King. And so we're here to honor Dr. King. We're not here to tear down Dr. King. We're here to honor Dr. King. Dr. King was not a perfect man. If you go through history, there are no perfect men. Or women. And I would be the first to say that I am very imperfect. But here goes. These are excerpts of this speech. Dr. King said, now I wanted to play the speech, but we couldn't get permission, so I'm going to read it. I think that's okay. I'm happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. 50 years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree is a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is badly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, the Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds himself in exile in his own land. So we've come here today to dramatize a shameful condition. In a sense, we've come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. The note was a promise that all men, yes, black men as well as white men, would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We must forever conduct our struggle on the high plane of dignity and discipline. We must not allow our creative protests to degenerate into physical violence. The marvelous new militancy which has engulfed the Negro community must not lead us to distrust all white people. For many of our white brothers, as evidenced by their presence here today, have come to realize that their destiny is tied up with our destiny. We cannot walk alone. And as we walk, we must make the pledge that we shall always march ahead We cannot turn back. There are those who are asking the devotees of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of the unspeakable horrors of police brutality. We can never be satisfied as long as our bodies, heavy with the fatigue of travel, cannot lodge in the motels of the highways and the hotels of the cities. We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro's basic mobility is from a smaller ghetto to a larger one. We cannot be satisfied as long as our children are stripped of their adulthood and robbed of their dignity by signs stating, "For whites only." We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro in Mississippi cannot vote and the Negro in New York believes he has nothing for which to vote. No, no, we're not satisfied, and we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. I say to you today, my friends, though, even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they would not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream. I have a dream that one day in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day, right there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside let freedom ring." And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curviest slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. When we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every city and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, great God Almighty, we're free at last. When we think about Dr. King's vision, Dr. King was not an American who hated America. He believed in the American dream. He believed in our Constitution. He believed in our Declaration of Independence. He believed that all men and women were created equal or are created equal. And I believe that if Dr. King were alive today, he would be so deeply saddened by the state we are in when it comes to race relations, because we've gone backwards and we have totally begun to destroy his vision of a colorblind society. And instead of a colorblind society, what we seem to want is a color-conscious society where people are judged by the color of their skin rather than the content of their character. That is unacceptable. And so for those of you, for those of you who love America, who care about its people, who want to see true racial harmony and racial reconciliation, you have to take up the mantle of Dr. King. And we have to push back against those forces that are trying to divide us, that are trying to dredge up the worst of the civil rights, not the worst of the civil rights movement, because the civil rights movement was positive, but what they do is they cherry pick history, and the true history of America is a history of whites and blacks and people coming together across racial and religious lines, people working together to bring about a different kind of society, and we were successful. I am a product of the American dream. I am a product of the civil rights movement, and because of Dr. King's actions, in 1964, he gave his speech in 1963. He wrote the letter from the Birmingham jail in 1963. When 1964, we passed a major civil rights act that addressed many of the things that he talked about in that speech. In 1965, we passed the Voting Rights Act, and it made it possible for blacks all across the South, where they had been denied the ability to vote in many places, to vote. And that is why you have so many, you know, black people in office in the South, is because we had a successful civil rights movement. In 1968, the Fair Housing Act was passed. So in my lifetime, I saw three major civil rights acts passed, and systemic racism ended with the passage of those three major civil rights acts. And what was left behind was individual racism. And individual racism is something that's rooted in the hearts and minds of all men from any racial and ethnic group. It's not confined to any particular race. Individual racism needs to be rooted out. It has reared its ugly head in our day, and we need to push back against it. We need to become the beloved community that Dr. King talked about, the one where we don't judge people by the color of their skin. We judge them by the content of their character. So thank you.
Carol Swain, a very, very moving presentation. Well, our keynote speaker is Dr. Ben Carson. Dr. Benjamin S. Carson, MD, is founder and chairman of the American Cornerstone Institute, and I like what he calls it. He calls it a new think tank, do tank. I love that, because we have plenty of think tanks that think but don't do. So it's a think tank, do tank, whose mission is to promote the four founding principles which are the cornerstones of our country: faith, liberty, community, and life, as well as to pursue common sense solutions that challenge conventional groupthink. He most recently served as the 17th Secretary of the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. For nearly 30 years, Secretary Carson served as Director of Pediatric Neurosurgery at the Johns Hopkins Children's Center, a position he assumed when he was just 33 years old, becoming the youngest major division director in the hospital's history. In 1987, he successfully performed the first separation of craniopagus twins conjoined at the back of the head. Dr. Carson received dozens of honors and awards in recognition of his achievements, including the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor. He has also been awarded over 70 honorary doctorate degrees. He's authored 9 books, 4 of which he co-wrote with his wife, Candy. That's impressive. That is impressive. Number 10 is coming out in May. Fantastic. Well, Dr. Carson and his wife co-founded the Carson Scholars Fund, which recognizes young people of all backgrounds of exceptional academic and humanitarian accomplishments. The fund is currently operating in 50 states and the District of Columbia, and this year is celebrating its 25th anniversary of the first awards ceremony. In honor of that, the organization has now awarded, wait for it, a total of more than 10,000 scholars, as well as more than $8 million in scholarships. Before the end of this year, yeah, that is fantastic. Before the end of this year, the Carson Scholars will have installed more than 250 Ben Carson reading rooms around the country. What a great idea that is. Born in Detroit to a single mother with a third grade education who worked multiple jobs to support their family, Secretary Carson was raised to love reading and education. He graduated from Yale University and earned his MD degree from the University of Michigan Medical School. He and his wife are the proud parents of 3 adult sons and 6 grandchildren. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great privilege to introduce our keynote speaker tonight, Dr. Ben Carson.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Well, Candy and I are absolutely delighted to be here and grateful to our friend, Dr. Carol Swain, for putting this together and for all of you for being here and recognizing that America is an exceptional place. And the emphasis on the American dream is something we need to begin to really take notice of once again. You know, there are those who are trying to tell us that there is no such thing as American exceptionalism. They're trying to tell us that we have a country that is defective, that is systemically racist. If our country was all that bad, why would people be forming caravans trying to get in here? You know, that doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And there are those who want you not to believe your eyes, but just to believe what they're telling you. And that's a problem. Now, I have to make a confession. You know, everybody gives disclaimers this day. And I have a disclaimer too. And that is, I'm not politically correct. And I never try to offend people. I don't think that's a nice thing to do. But some people get offended at anything. So even though I don't want to offend anybody, if anybody is offended, too bad. You know, one of the things that we really concentrate on with American Cornerstone is freedom, liberty. That includes freedom of speech. And there are those who say that that's not threatened in our country because the government is not restricting people's speech. But the fact of the matter is, if big tech and media restricts your speech and cancels you and punishes you, and the government is complicit, it is exactly the same thing as the government restricting our speech. And we need to understand that. But it's also very important that the reasonable people, the logical people, the God-fearing people in our country do not act like those who are on the other side. We can't allow ourselves to be dragged into the mud. We must encourage conversation. And one of the problems with the people who are logical thinkers is they frequently lack courage. And they just stand in the corner with their head down and hope that nobody calls them a nasty name. We can't do that anymore. There's too much at stake. We're talking about our young people and their future. And somebody has to fight for them. We can't expect just a few people to carry that banner. That is so critical. And we need to promote the ideal that it's okay to disagree. You know, if two people think the same way about everything, one of them isn't necessary. You know, that's why God gave us brains. You know, we all have different experiences, and obviously we're going to think different things. It's okay. And we can't let the forces of division and hatred prevail by making us think that we're enemies. You can take the most radical left-wing person and the most radical right-wing person in this country, and they're going to agree on 90% of stuff. But the haters take that 10% that they don't agree on, and they massage that, and they try to make that into the biggest factor in our lives. We must be smart enough to resist that and recognize that all of this animosity that's going on right now is intentional. You know, you may remember, some of you who are old enough, Nikita Khrushchev, and how he said to Dwight Eisenhower, "Your grandchildren's children will live under communism, and we will never have to fire a shot." What did he know? He knew that in order to change this country, you weren't going to win a physical war, but that all you had to do is gain control of the educational system so that you could indoctrinate the children. And people have known that forever. I mean, you can go back to the Bible. Proverbs 22:6, what does it say? "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he'll not depart from it." And, you know, Vladimir Lenin said, "Give me your children to teach for 4 years, and the seed that I plant will never be uprooted." People have known forever the importance of indoctrination of young people. Khrushchev also knew that you had to gain control of the media so that you could spoon-feed the population only those things you wanted them to know, and you could shield them from the things that you didn't want them to know. And he knew you had to replace trust in God with trust in government. And he recognized that if you drive the national debt to such levels, astronomical levels, you could then justify massive taxation, redistribution of wealth, and total dependence on the government. Does any of that sound familiar? This is all the stuff that's going on right now. And it's going to be necessary for people to talk about this. You can't just say, "Yeah, that's terrible that that's happening. What's on TV tonight?" You know, you really cannot take that attitude. This has got to be something that's very serious for every single one of us. And, you know, America, we're being taught, or our kids are being taught in school, is a horrible place because of slavery. Now, we have had our problems, like every other nation, because we've been inhabited by people. It's a problem. People are not perfect. People make mistakes. All people do. That's why we need a Savior, quite frankly. But but I got to tell you something about slavery. Slavery's been around since there have been civilizations. You know, you look in the Bible. You know, Abraham's seed, they were made slaves in Egypt. It was a horrible situation, and they needed to be delivered. And there are many other mentions of it. And you look throughout societies in history, slavery has existed. So there is nothing unique about the United States in that we had slavery. There is something unique, though, about us. And that is we had so many people who were vehemently opposed to slavery that we were willing to fight a civil war and lose a large portion of our population to stop it. That's what we need to make sure that our children understand about this nation. They also need to understand that because of a person's skin color, you cannot associate them with slave ownership. The majority of people in the South did not own slaves, white people. That was for the aristocrats. That was not for everybody. And there were black slave owners as well. Interestingly enough, if you go back and you really look through the records, you will find that in 1670, the House of Burgess in the Commonwealth of Virginia made a declaration that blacks and Indians could not own Christian slaves, which was their euphemism for white slaves, because some owned them. So whether you owned a slave or whether you were a slave, it's not a matter of a particular race. It's a matter of whether you have an advantage. And people have had advantages throughout history, and they have used those advantages to hurt other people. And that happens in all races. Where do you think the slaves came from? Believe me, it wasn't the fact that the Spaniards and the Portuguese were able to go into the jungle and grab these people. Believe me, they would not have been able to do that. It was because the tribes were having wars, and frequently, if they didn't kill their opponents, they took them as slaves. And then they found out, wow, we can sell these people and get all kinds of goodies. That's how it happened. So there's plenty of guilt to go around. It doesn't have to all reside in one place. But then you have to really stop and think about how much progress has been made in this country in terms of race just in my lifetime. I remember as a six-year-old seeing whites and colored signs here in Tennessee. But I also remember as a youngster when a black person came on television in a non-servile role, and everybody called everybody into the living room to see it. It was so exciting. Come and see this. And now you have black generals and admirals and CEOs of Fortune 500 companies and university presidents, even Ivy League schools. We've had a black president elected twice. We have a black vice president, sort of. The point being, that even though some people don't want to admit it, the landscape has changed drastically. And we've made enormous progress, but now we have people who are trying to convince everybody that we haven't made any progress and that we have this evil society that exists. And we have to be willing to speak up and tell them about the things that are going on. Also, we need to recognize that this country is an enormously great place because we've had a lot of enormously talented people, and they've come from all backgrounds. You know, we look at the, some people say the young black male is an endangered species in America because there are more young black males in the penal system than there are in higher education system. And it's true. But what happened? We've allowed a situation to occur and we have not really devoted much attention to it. And we've actually had policies promoted by our government that have destroyed the black family. And 70 to 80% of those young black males grow up in a home that has no father, no authority figure in some cases. Now, that wasn't my case, because my mother was an authority figure. But in most cases, they're not like my mother was. And sometimes the first authority figure they run into is either a police officer or someone in the neighborhood who's badder than they are. In any case, it doesn't work out well. Frequently, they end up in the penal system, which becomes a university for more crime. And now, when we have these various district attorneys and people who don't even want to prosecute crimes, then that university becomes even more powerful, more effective in our society. All of which is adding to the perception that we have a system that doesn't work. These are things that is very important for people to understand. But, you know, those young black boys, we all need to be interested in their welfare. And anybody could take that 6-year-old young black male and take a walk down the streets of Nashville and give him a black history lesson he would never forget. You could start by pointing to his shoes and saying it was John Matzliger, a black man who invented the automatic shoe lasting machine, which revolutionized the shoe industry throughout the world. And then you step on that clean street and you tell him it was Charles Brooks, a black man who invented the street sweeper, those machines with the big brushes. And down that street comes a big refrigerated tractor trailer truck. Tell him it was Frederick Jones, a black man who invented the refrigeration system for trucks, later adopted for airplanes, trains, boats. And it comes to a stop at the red light. You can tell him it was Garrett Morgan, a black man who invented the traffic signal. And you can also tell how he invented the gas mask, saved lots of lives during the war. While you're talking about the war, Henrietta Bradbury, a black woman who invented the underwater cannon, made it possible to launch torpedoes from submarines. And while you're talking about black women, you'll see a beautiful black woman walking down the street. A black man did not invent her. But you can use that opportunity to talk about Madam C.J. Walker, a black woman who invented cosmetic products for women of dark complexion, was the first woman of any nationality to become a millionaire on her own efforts. And then you walk past the hospital, and you can talk about Charles Drew and his contributions to blood banking, understanding of the function of blood plasma. Daniel Hell Williams, the first successful open-heart surgery in the world, had an operative mortality rate of less than 1.5%. You look up at the surgical light, Thomas Edison. You didn't know he was black, did you? Well, he wasn't. But his right-hand man, Louis Latimer, was. And you can tell how Lewis Latimer came up with the filament that made the light bulb work for more than 2 or 3 days, invented the electric lamp diagram, the telephone for Alexander Graham Bell, was a tremendous inventor in his own right. Most people have never heard of him. And you'll walk past the railroad tracks and you can talk about Andrew Beard, black man, invented the automatic railroad car coupler, spurred on the Industrial Revolution. Elijah McCoy, the automatic lubrication system for locomotive engines. He had so many great inventions. People are always saying, is that a McCoy? Is that the real McCoy? You got people like David Duke talking about the real McCoy, don't even know who they're paying homage to. And I'm just barely scratching the surface. But you know what's important about America? Is I could take that same walk down the street for virtually any nationality in this country and point out tremendous contributions, because our diversity is not a problem, it is a strength. And these people who are pushing policies that are antithetical to Dr. King's dream, what are they trying to do? They are trying to make people act like animals. Now, let me tell you what I'm talking about. If you look at the human brain and you put that next to an animal's brain, let's take a dog, for instance. The animal's brain will have a very well-developed midbrain, because the midbrain allows you to react. So you see things, you hear things, you react to them very quickly. The human brain is not that well-developed in the midbrain, but it has huge frontal lobes. Those allow you to process information, actual intellectual functioning, grasp information from the past and the present, project it into a plan, assess a situation. In other words, to be able to judge somebody by the content of their character and not the color of their skin. They want us and they want our children to act like animals and just look at the color of someone's skin. How utterly ridiculous. And as a neurosurgeon, when I would take someone to the operating room and cut that scalp and peel it back and take off that bone flap, I would be actually operating on the thing that makes that person who they are. It's not the hair, it's not the skin, it is the brain that makes you who you are. We need to begin to emphasize that. We need to act like human beings and not like animals, and not allow ourselves to be manipulated the way they are. And that's such an important concept. The American dream. Why does everyone want to come here? Why is this the destination place? Well, you know, as a youngster, when I was 9 years old, I remember sitting on the ghetto stairs in Boston. We had moved from Detroit to Boston after my parents got divorced. And I was looking through the building across the street, through which a sunbeam was shining. All the windows had been broken out. And I saw that sunbeam, and it made me think about my future. And I remember distinctly thinking that I probably would not live to be more than 20 or 25 years old. Why? Because that's what I saw around me. Both of my favorite older cousins had been killed. It's just the way it was. But my mother had a different thinking than most of the people around her. People were always talking about how the system was against you and how you couldn't succeed. My mother was always saying, if anybody can do anything, you can do it too, except you can do it better. She was constantly the cheerleader. And we moved back to Detroit, and I was a terrible student. I was the worst student you've ever seen. I remember once we were having an argument in the schoolyard about who was the dumbest kid in the school. It wasn't a big argument. Everybody agreed it was me. But then someone tried to extend the argument to who was the dumbest person in the world. And I said, but there are billions of people in the world. And they said, yep, and you're the dumbest one. Well, to make matters worse, after recess, we went back in the classroom and we had a math quiz. Now, I had a basic philosophical disagreement with the math teacher who thought you need to know your timetables. And since in those days they were printed on the back of the little notebooks, I said, I don't need to learn these. I can look them up anytime I want. Well, it didn't work on the test. And you had to pass your test paper to the person behind you. They would correct it. And then the teacher would call your name, and you had to report your score out loud. Not a problem if you got 100 or 95 or 90. Major problem if you got a zero and just had an argument about who was the dumbest person in the world. So I started scheming. I said, I know what, when the teacher calls my name, I'll mumble. And the teacher will think I said one thing, and the girl behind me will think I said something else. So I said, yeah. She said, 9. Benjamin, you got 9 right? This is wonderful. I knew you could do it if you just applied yourself, class. This is a great day. Benjamin, it's gotten 9. Finally, the girl behind me couldn't take it any longer. And she stood up and said, he said none. Well, the kids were rolling in the aisles. And if I could have disappeared into thin air, never to be heard from again in the history of the world, I would gladly have done so. But I couldn't. So I had to act like it didn't bother me. But it did. It bothered me a lot. Not enough to make me study, but it bothered me a lot. But it was my mother. My mother said that she was a domestic, and she cleaned other people's houses, and she went from one house to the next. She was leaving 5 in the morning, get back at midnight, because she didn't like the idea of welfare. But she was actually a spy, because she said, these people live in these beautiful homes, they're doing so well, I want to know what they're doing. And she finally concluded it was because they were always reading books. They weren't always watching TV. So she came home and imposed that on us. And we were not happy campers. In today's world, we would have called social services on her. But she said we had to read books, turn off the TV set. And I hated it in the beginning. But after a while, I actually began to enjoy reading those books. I read about explorers and scientists and surgeons and entrepreneurs. And I began to realize, the more these stories I read, that the person who has the most to do with what happens to you in life is you. It's not somebody else. Nobody else can get in your way unless you let them get in your way. Completely changed my way of thinking. And you know, my mother's friends just criticized her like crazy. But she got the last laugh, because one son became a brain surgeon and the other became a rocket scientist. So she obviously knew what she was doing. But that dream, that American dream, it's available for anybody in our society. And the reason that America is the destination for so many people around the world is because they know that. And you have probably noticed that a lot of people who come here, take for instance, a few decades ago, the Vietnamese boat people. Did you notice how they would be out in front of the 7-Eleven sweeping? And then they'd be pumping the gas. And then they'd be behind the cash register. And then they would own the place. People come here and they see these incredible opportunities. But we somehow sometimes convince our people that those opportunities don't exist. If you think you're a victim, you are a victim. And that's why critical race theory is such a bad idea because it teaches minority kids that they are victims, that no matter what happens, you can't get a fair shake. You can't. And that is completely untrue. And it teaches the white kids that you should feel guilty, that you and your relatives are oppressors. So what do you have? A combination of white guilt and minority victimhood. And it leads to some of the most absurd policy making that you can possibly imagine. And we're seeing the results of that. And that's why it becomes so important for us to push back against those kinds of things and have the right kind of education. And one of the things that we're doing at American Cornerstone is advancing our Little Patriots program, littlepatriots.com. You can go there. And we have a K-5 education program that gives the true history of America, warts and all, but kids will come away from it feeling great. There's a little guide called Liberty Eagle. It's our symbol. Liberty Eagle has a right wing and a left wing. A Liberty Eagle cannot fly with two right wings, cannot fly with two left wings. But we need to begin to teach our children the concept of working together. We're called the United States of America. That's what makes us strong. We're too strong to be destroyed by China or Russia or North Korea or Iran, but we can be destroyed from within. Jesus said at first, a house divided against itself cannot stand. Abraham Lincoln echoed it again. It is absolutely true. But what happens when we unite? Now, one of the dangers that we must be cognizant of, things are going to change in this country. People are waking up in droves on both sides of the aisle. And there's going to be a massive shift of power. I think that's a pretty safe prediction. It is critical that when that occurs, those of us who are logical don't try to do the same things back. You can't do that. Instead, we must get back to some of our founding principles, like faith. Faith teaches us to love our neighbor, not to hate our neighbor, not to cancel our neighbor if they disagree with us, but to love our neighbor. Liberty, freedom, freedom of speech, freedom of religion. We must not tell people that you can't talk about God in public, that you can't talk about God in our schools. That's not who we are. You know, this country was founded on Judeo-Christian values and principles. We used to have in our history books stories about the bulletproof Washington. You know, George Washington was a courier for General Braddock during the French and Indian War. And the couriers riding back and forth with people being shot at. All the couriers were killed, except for Washington, who had his horse shot out from underneath him, who had four bullet holes in his coat, who had bullet fragments in his hair, but no wounds. And years later, after the war, still before he became president, but he was quite prominent at the time, he was back in the area, and one of the Indian chiefs who had been involved in that war, he was elderly and about to die, he said, "Please take me, I must see this man." And when he saw General Washington, he said, "Sir, I wanted to meet you because I'm an expert marksman, and I shot you many times." And my men shot you many times. And I just wanted, before I died, to see the man who is protected by the great spirit above. You know, that used to be in our history books. And there are many other amazing stories that tell you that God, providence, played a very vital role in the creation of this country. And we should not get away from those godly principles. And there is a philosophy that I've put forth that I think will lead to success in life for anyone. It's called Think Big. Each one of those letters means something special. The T is for talent, which God gave to every single person, not just the ability to sing and dance and throw a ball. Nothing wrong with those things. But intellectual talent. Do you realize that over the last 100+ years, over 90% of the world-changing inventions came from this country? Because we had an atmosphere that encouraged entrepreneurship and innovative thinking. We need to get back to that again. All of this one-size-fits-all stuff, that is not American. And that goes for the way we treat viruses, too. You know? I mean, don't get me started on COVID. It is absolutely absurd. But, you know, here's what's interesting about it. God is fixing the problem regardless of how stupid our policies are. You'll notice the virus is getting weaker and weaker, even though it's spreading more easily, which means pretty soon just about everyone will have it. And we'll have immunity, we'll have natural immunity. So it doesn't matter how stupid they keep being, it doesn't matter, we're still going to conquer this, thanks to God. Yeah. The H is for honesty. Lead a clean and honest life. Don't put skeletons in the closet, they won't come back to haunt you. Just when you don't want to see them. And what a difference that makes in the way that you can do things. I remember one day I was operating and a phone call comes into the operating room. Nurse holds the phone up to my ear and I'm told that the state of Florida is trying to attach my wages for child support. I said, what? I said, I have 3 children. I support them very well. And they said, no, there's a woman in Florida who says you are the father of her son. And she knows where you went to high school, college, medical school, even has a picture of you in scrubs. So on the basis of that, they're pursuing a paternity suit. And then it escalated. I had to get my lawyer involved. And they said, send us a blood specimen so we can do DNA testing. And I said, what? If I send you a blood specimen, it's going to end up at a murder scene and I'll be in jail for the rest of my life. But it escalated a bit and then it just fizzled away, just died. Because what happens is a lot of times they see people who are out and about all the time. They figure they've been messing around. They don't even know all the people they've been messing around with, so they should be easy targets. But I had one major advantage. I knew that the only woman I had ever slept with was my wife. I didn't have to scratch my head and say, you know, was there some conference in Tennessee? I didn't have to do that. So clean, honest life really uncomplicates your life. The I is for insight, which comes from listening to people who've already gone where you're trying to go, learn from their triumphs and learn from their mistakes. A wise person can learn from someone else's mistakes. A stupid person has to make them all themselves. N is for nice. Be nice to people. Because once they get over the suspicion of why you're being nice, they'll be nice to you. You get so much more done when they're being nice. And just try it. Try in this next week to intentionally look for people that you don't normally talk to and that you are not nice to and that you ignore, and go out of your way to be nice to them. It's fun. It really is. And the reactions that you will get in many cases will be quite amazing. And you'll make some new friends. And can you imagine what kind of a society we could have if people just started thinking about others more than themselves? We can do this. It's part of who we are as Americans. The K is for knowledge, which makes you into a more valuable person. The more of it you have, the more valuable you become. The B is for books, which is the mechanism for getting that knowledge. And it's never too late. You know, my mother had less than a third grade education, but she got her GED. She went on to college. In 1994, she got an honorary doctorate degree, so she was Dr. Carson, too. The second I is for in-depth learning, learning for the sake of knowledge and understanding as opposed to superficial learners. And the G is the most important letter for God. You know, why do people criticize public officials who talk about God and say that somehow we're violating separation of church and state, which is not mentioned in the Constitution, by the way. There's no reason that you have to separate your faith in God from the way that you live. And we need to make that clear to everybody these days. Godly principles of loving your neighbor, of caring about those who cannot care for themselves, of developing your God-given talents to the utmost so that you become valuable to the people around you, having values and principles that guide your life. Those are the things that made America into a great country. That's why we were able to rise from a ragtag bunch of militiamen to the pinnacle of the world in record time. That's why we were able to change the course of the world during World War II. Think about D-Day and those young men, many of them only 17 or 18 years old, invading the beaches of Normandy, being mowed down by machine gun fire. Hundreds of bodies, 1,000 bodies laying dead on the beach. Were the others frightened? Did they turn back? Yes, they were frightened, but they did not turn back. They stepped over those bodies and they overwhelmed the Axis forces, knowing in many cases that they would never see their loved ones again. They would never see their homeland again. They didn't do it for themselves. They did it for us so that we could live in peace and freedom. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is our turn to do it for those who are coming after us. Thank you very much.
I'm so glad we had this time together. Well, we've come to the part of the evening where we are about to close the program, but I want to thank all the people that made this possible. And this could not have been done without the energy, the youth, the vigor, and stamina of Moms for Liberty. And so would the Moms for Liberty please stand? And we have the founder and co-founder of Moms for Liberty here today. Would you stand, please? And they're going to be part of a panel tomorrow. And Moms for Liberty, that's one group. I've met Moms for America, moms all across America. Moms are standing up, and they're fighting for their children. They're fighting for other people's children. And so we have to applaud them. We need to back them. And they're doing something that we all should be proud of. We should be proud of them because they're doing something that's very important for our nation at this moment. And many of them have never been involved in politics. They don't see themselves as politicians. They're people who care about America. And so we're very thankful to have them as a partner. And they, this event was planned without a professional planner. We didn't know what we were doing. And I'd also like to thank my staff, the people that are working with me now. Sandy, Alex, Jeff. Would you stand and be acknowledged? And there's some vendors also. Are you thanking the vendors?
You can thank them.
No, that's okay. Okay, I'm supposed to do Moms for Liberty, and I was supposed to get off the stage, but I started talking, and I forgot.
Carol Swain. Just I have just a few little housekeeping details. Dr. Swain and Dr. Carson will be available for the next 30 minutes over there. We'll sign books. So if you want to get a book and get their signatures, they'll be right over there for the next 30 minutes. Also, if you want a dessert, I'm told there are desserts in the back room. I'm also told it's cheesecake. Mmm. Also, a reminder for those of you coming to the panels tomorrow. Tomorrow morning, the event will start at 9 o'clock. The panelists will be here and the staff will be here at 8 o'clock. There is a farmer's market here, and so you should allow plenty of time to find some parking space. So on that note, I also want to say what a tremendous privilege it was to be the Master of Ceremonies here tonight. And I want to thank all of you for coming. This is fantastic. The future of America is bright with all of your great work. Thank you and have a great evening.